guys today. We're very lucky to have a guest speaker to come and speak with us today. His name is Kyle. He's from Tandemic and he's also a social entrepreneur. All right, so he's going to talk to us a little bit about lean startup and crowdfunding. So we really hope that we can learn a lot from today's session. And feel free to ask questions, right? All right, so please help me to welcome Kyle.
Thank you so much. So as was mentioned, I'm Cal, and I work with an organization called Tandemic. And so what we do at Tandemic is we work with a lot of companies you probably recognize, Microsoft, Standard Chartered, Media Prima, on applying different approaches to innovation. But one of the other things that I've also done is I've started several companies. And so what I'm going to talk about today is a little bit about some of the different approaches that we use in starting up companies, working with these companies to launch new products and services, and how you guys might be able to apply them either in your own startups, but most important, I think most immediately in the projects that you're going to, in the crowdfunding projects, I think that you guys are all going to be working on. So that's a little bit about me. What I'd like to know is a little bit about you guys. You are in what year now? Third year. Out of 3 years or 4 years? 4 years. So you got one more year left. And you guys are engineering students? Yes. What kind of engineering? Mechanical. All mechanical. Chemical. Mechanical. Electrical. Anything else? Civil? No. Uncivil engineering? No. Okay. Okay, very cool. And any of you guys are thinking of starting up a company at some point? One? But then I heard people say yes and they didn't put up their hands. okay, that's cool. So you'll find some of this stuff useful. Now, increasingly, large companies are also looking at it as a way of pursuing innovation. And so this is really one of the big questions that are faced by large companies. And so our goal today is actually you're going to work on building your first lean startup experiment today. So in the next couple of hours, as we go through this, that'll be what we'll be doing. But before that, a couple of notes is that this will not be like a passive workshop. So you guys will actually be doing things today. I won't be talking to you the whole time. But the first thing I want to do is I want to focus on this idea of crowdfunding, because I know at the end of this course, you guys have to do some kind of crowdfunding campaign. You need to raise some money. What do you need to raise it for? Ourselves, okay. And put it in your pocket or like what? What? Cherry Makan? No. What do you guys need to raise it for? Charity? Okay. Does everyone agree with this? What's your name, sorry? Kenton. Clinton. Does everyone agree with Clinton? It's charity. Some of it, no. What are the other things that you raise it for then? So again, into your pocket, is it? So let me ask you guys this. Let's say you're crowdfunding for yourselves. Like, why would someone give you money? Because they have extra. Okay. excuse me. Do you have extra money? any other reasons? Any thoughts? They share the same passion. So they want to do something like what you're doing, is it? Okay, that's a pretty good. So I'm going to ask you guys, I'm going to use post-it notes yet because I don't want to write on these things with Sharpie. I'll get in trouble for that. I want to ask you, any of you guys backed a Kickstarter campaign or anything like that before? No one? Yes, you have. Cool. What have you backed? A game, cool. What's that? A board game, nice. And why did you decide to back it? Yeah. Okay. So you like the product. It sounds like what you're telling me is they had credibility as well because they had previously done projects that had worked, right? So you funded them because you liked the product, they had credibility. What any other reasons you funded it? Why did you put money up for this thing? Oh, okay. So cost saving. Okay. Anything else? All right. Cool. So here we've got three reasons people. I'm going to put them up here. Three reasons people support crowdfunding campaigns. Any of you guys? Anyone else supported a crowdfunding campaign besides Kickstarter? Anything else? Indiegogo, no, okay. It's the real name of a crowdfunding platform. Okay, let me ask you guys to guess. Like, when people put up money for crowdfunding campaigns, like, why do they do it? They're interested in the product, so they want that product, right? And maybe there's nowhere else they can get it. Yeah, so I don't know, did you guys see there's a cool campaign out with like a camera bag / laptop bag that I don't know if you guys watched Kickstarter. You saw that one, right? Yeah, I was like, that bag is really cool, but it's so expensive. but you can't get the product anywhere else, right? What else? Keep it coming. What else have you guys got? What's that? Other reasons people support Kickstarter campaigns? Just because? I think there is a just because kind of, you know, do you have any examples in mind? Potato, exactly, right? Have you guys seen, do you know what the potato salad?
Yes.
Did anyone not know? I'm sure there's some people who not know. Do you want to explain the potato salad? So if I remember correctly, this guy started a Kickstarter campaign and he's just like, fund me to make a potato salad. Did I get that right? That's it. And he raised like, you know, $30,000 to make a potato salad, right? And so I think, for me, I think it's about supporting weirdness, right? They're just like, that's funny. And, you know, they support that, right? So. All right. Anything else? It's easy. But easy is not a reason for me to like give money, right? Okay. So, let's say there's not a lot of friction, right, in the process. So that's something that aids the whole process, not a lot of friction in giving. I'll show you guys a video from a Kickstarter campaign. Maybe you guys can tell me. Give me some more things that you see, maybe that are reasons that people donate to Kickstarter. So you know, for what was your name? Sorry. Yeah, Lore. At Law. Okay. So Law, you'll like this one because this is also a game. Kickstarter campaign. This is one of my favorite Kickstarter campaign videos. So have a look and try to figure out like what were some of the factors that went in, especially if there are new ones that haven't been mentioned, that went into this campaign. I don't remember how much they raised, but it was like over half a million. It was a large amount.
Oh, sorry, I didn't see you there. You caught me indulging in one of my many impressive hobbies. I'm Tim Schaefer, and I'm a man of many passions. Drumming, skydiving, like charity or something. But one of the things I'm most passionate about is making games. And one of my favorite types of games to make is adventure games. But these days it seems like adventure games are almost a bit of a lost art form. They exist in our dreams and our memories and in Germany. people come up to me all the time and they say,
you should make a point-and-click graphic adventure.
You know, I would, except...
Adventure games are not dead!
Okay, I'm on your side, but if I were to go to a publisher right now and pitch an adventure game, they'd laugh in my face.
But I have money, and I'd buy a copy.
Well, that's nice, but unfortunately, it's not enough money to make a game.
But there's a ton of people out there that are just like me. They'd buy one, too.
I wonder if that's true.
Dude, it's totally true. There's so many people
talking to
buy
you.
It.
What if there are a lot of adventure game fans out there who want an adventure game? I wonder if there's some way that I could talk to them directly. Cut out publishers altogether. And that's when it occurred to me, Kickstarter. We can use Kickstarter to make a fan-funded old-school adventure game. It's perfect. We got the perfect team here at Double Fine to make it. We got the inventor of the genre here, Ron Gilbert. Oh, look, there he is right now. Maybe he'll help us. He'll help us. But that's only half the story. We'll also be filming the whole thing as we go. Well, I mean, these guys will be here. This is,
Paul?
One of the guys from,
Two-Player Productions?
The people making that documentary about nachos?
Notch.
Whatever.
Two-PlayerProductions.com.
These talented documenteers will be filming the whole process from beginning to end and putting it up on the internet as we go. A high-quality, serialized documentary that provides an unprecedented look into what really happens when a company like Double Fine makes a game. You know how they say you don't want to see how sausage gets made? We are going to show you how the sausage gets made. We are going to take our sausage and shove it in your face, warts and all. Whether it goes well or whether it all goes to hell, we're going to show everything. Isn't that exciting? But the conversation won't just be a one-way street. This is a game for adventure fans, funded by adventure fans, so we want to make it with adventure fans. You'll be able to talk back to us on the exclusive online community of people who funded the game. You'll give input on the concept art, the music, and your input will actually affect the direction the game takes. It'll be like a collaboration. Or more like Little Orphan Annie, where we're the cute little red-haired girl who sings and tap dances for your pleasure, and you're like Daddy Warbucks, who's like bald or something, but he's cool and everybody likes him. And that's the point. If you back this Kickstarter project, you will be cool and everybody will like you, guaranteed. So, we are asking for this much to make the game and this much to film it. And that may seem like a lot of money, but it's really not that much for a game budget these days. It's pretty small, actually, but we're not scared. It's going to be an adventure, both the process and the product. We could possibly go, oh man, come on. I hate these. There it is. Okay, great. So, what's going to happen? No one can say for sure, but here's my promise to you. Either the game will be great, or it'll be a spectacular failure, caught on camera for everyone to see. Either way, you win. What could possibly go wrong?
So I picked up a couple of new ones there. What have you guys found? Yeah, I think that's really special. It makes kind of people feel like they're not part of the mainstream. It's like you like adventure games. You're special. The publishers, the evil publishers, don't want adventure games anymore. But you will support them, right? And then it's like, oh yeah, I'm part of that club. I wanna support that. So it's kind of tied into a hipster identity. That word crossed my mind. But hipsters are mainstream now. By the way, how do you anyone know how do you drown a hipster? How do you drown a hipster? In the mainstream. Thank you. okay, so I've got hipster identity. I mean, it doesn't have to be hipster, right? It just has to be something that makes people feel special, right? I'll just put feel special here as well. All right, what else? So that's pretty cool, right? Like, you get to be part of this online community, and you get to co-design the game with them. Yeah. So I think there's a big theme across the whole video is, like, giving people a sense of ownership. It's like, you're the funder, even though you only gave us $20, right? You are the people who are really powering this. So I think there's a sense of ownership. And for me, the bigger thing underneath that is, you get something in return, right? Yeah. Like, I think one of the biggest failures of crowdfunding is it's like, oh, we want your money, but we're not going to give you anything back. And it's like, well, why would I give money to that, right? I mean, some people do it out of the goodness of their hearts, but most people won't. So ownership and get something in return. Anything else? And can't get the product anywhere else, right? That's what that was about. So in this case, in the case of, I don't know, in the case of all of the, like that bag that we were talking about, right? You can't get that product anywhere else. In this game, it's not going to happen unless you guys fund it, because the middleman, the evil middleman, is not going to let it happen, right? Anything else you guys saw?
It captures your interest.
Yeah, it's funny, right? I put the whole weirdness point that you guys had talked about earlier. I got that one down too. I mean, it is pretty the guy is pretty weird, you know. And it's like, but that's what makes it charming and funny, right? And so the pitch is not like, oh, finance this video and you'll get these four things in return. It's like, hey, I'm this guy who's like, you know, totally full of myself and
casual.
And you know, I don't know. But yeah, so those are some of the basic points. So I think what we've done here is we've got this list of 9 items, which I think is a really good list of 9 items for how to create a great crowdfunding pitch when it comes to you guys to do. The only thing I would add to this is, who's been to Kickstarter at all? Who's looked at that website? Put your hands up. Couple of you guys. Okay, so I think it's really, I mean, Kickstarter is the most successful crowdfunding site for products out there. I think it's useful to look at the campaigns because on the right side, you'll see they have a reward section. And so like, if you fund this, you'll get a t-shirt up to this amount. If you fund this to this amount, we'll give you a PDF copy of the book we're writing. And if you fund to this amount, we'll sign it and we'll send it to you by mail. And so for each level, there are different rewards, and I think that's the key to that website being so successful. Because again, they've created different levels at which you can contribute, and also different levels at which you can get something in return. So I feel like I haven't just given my money to you, but I actually got something in return. So as you think about, you know, why is it that someone will give me money to put in my pocket? It's because they will get something in return, right? Or why will they give money for charity? It's because hopefully they get something. And the thing, it could be as simple as a thank you card from some kids, right? Who you know, benefited from whatever program you ran. Any thoughts, questions, comments? I'm just going to wrap up the conversation on crowdfunding, if we're okay with that. Sound good? Okay, cool. All right, so now I'm going to talk a little bit about Lean Startup. I'm going to talk about why we do it. And I'm going to start with a project that we did. We started 2 years ago. So we have this website called Hati. And if you Google an NGO in Malaysia, chances are you will stumble on Hati. It's the largest open database of NGOs in Malaysia. And it's something that we started working on a couple of years ago. And what happened was people would email us and they'd be like, hey, I'm looking for a volunteering opportunity and I can't find one. Can you help me find a volunteering opportunity? How many of you guys have tried to look for volunteering opportunities? Any of you guys have done that? Yeah. And what did you find? Did you find anything?
I'm for you. Has their own volunteering.
Anything else?
There's another one, and attend to make good.
Do something good.
Yeah, good.
Yes,
to do something.
That's ours.
Yeah.
Okay. So, and then what did you find?
Oh, I couldn't really find anything online really easily, so I went through my church.
Yeah, you couldn't find anything online. Did you want to add something? No. Okay. And what did you find?
Another charity, but it was on Facebook.
It was on Facebook. Yeah. Ah, okay, cool. So, one of the biggest challenges. So this is, you guys are in the generation of people after Do Something Good was created, and after all of the things that came after Do Something Good. So basically, a lot of people before Do Something Good were in this, and I'm for you, were in this situation. Whereas, like, I tried to find volunteering opportunities, but I couldn't find any. And so people would email us that they get frustrated doing that. And so we're like, well, why don't we build a website where people can find volunteering opportunities and NGOs can recruit for volunteers? Makes sense. And so we decided to do that, and we were seeing like people going through their churches. It's like, oh, my uncle knew an NGO, and if that wasn't the case, they just wouldn't volunteer. So it was a huge waste. And we said, okay, well, why don't we create this website that does that? And we went and talked to different people in the social sector, like experts and like consultants in the social sector, and we said, what do you think if we created this website? What do you guys think they said? They said no. And why do you think they said no? It doesn't benefit them? Interesting. Okay. And you said, okay, because? Why not? Okay. Anything, any other thoughts? So the answer, the actual answer is people said, you know, don't do something good. Don't make do something good because they were like, Malaysians will never volunteer. And we're like, okay. But anyway, I decided, I spent my summer vacation in France. Maybe this is 3 years ago now or 2 years ago, building the website. You know, with a couple of team members, and so we were coding it, and we decided to build it anyway, right? We went ahead and we built it, but we had in mind this idea that actually it would be really tough to recruit volunteers, because everyone told us, like, Malaysians won't volunteer. Do you guys think that's true, by the way? No. Yeah, you guys are right, it's not true. So our expectation was that recruiting volunteers would be tough. What actually happened is volunteers enthusiastically embraced the platform. We put up like one, you know, volunteer opportunity for a graphic designer. We get like 7 graphic designers. We're like, we only need one, but that's cool. So that was good. But we did run into problems. Any guesses as to where we ran into problems? Spam, okay. Anything else? We did have bots trying to take out down. I mean, there are people trying to take down our websites all the time. It's just the fact of having a website on the internet. You know, people try to take it down. What's that? Dishonest posts? No, we were okay on that side. So our real issue was that we thought that NGOs would love this platform because for them it's like volunteers are good, right? It's free labor and stuff like that to contribute to their projects. What we actually found was that NGOs didn't recruit volunteers. And there are a couple of reasons for that. One of them was that actually recruiting and managing volunteers is almost a full-time job on its own. So you guys think that as you go volunteer, you're actually helping an NGO. NGO's like, crap, I have to figure out something for this person to do. I have to watch them and make sure that, you know, they don't screw up my kids, you know, or they don't break stuff, or, you know, all these things, or I have to make sure they're properly trained going in. And then this guy or girl is going to show up for like one day and I might not see them ever again. And so because of the churn of volunteers and the need for them to understand what's going on, it was actually very, very difficult for NGOs to manage and handle volunteers. That was one side of it. The other side is we discovered that NGOs were actually a lot less technically savvy than we thought they were. And so we put up like volunteering opportunities on the website for NGOs, and they'd be like, oh, great, can you fax us the list of volunteers? And we'd be like, fax? Yeah, we used to have one of those. So basically, you know, basically a lot of NGOs were scared to use it, you know, they weren't comfortable with using an online platform to recruit volunteers. And so that was an issue. And then the last issue that we had was basically the assumption was, at least the NGOs assumed it, we assumed also that if you put up an event, not everyone would show up, but most people would show up, right? Now, how many of you guys have joined a Facebook event without ever intending to go to that event? Yes. Thank you for being honest. I think many of us have. And so the problem is that in this Facebook generation, the meaning of register for event or join event has changed. And people are like, yeah, I'll join this event and maybe I'll go. They are not like, I'll join this event and for sure I'll go, right? And so what's happening is NGOs are maybe expecting about 70% of people to show up or 80% of people to show up. In reality, like 50% of people were showing up. And that's just something we see across all kinds of events. So like we run community meetups every month and like 50% of registrants show up. That's fine for us. We just push the registrations up higher. But you know, this was an expectation mismatch. Basically, we had disappointed NGOs. So we did a study on the state of volunteering afterwards, and we found that there are about 140,000 registered volunteers in Malaysia, which is, and 40,000 of them are active. But the real issue was, and this is actually not a lot, but it's enough. The real issue is that less than 40, the sign is in the wrong direction, but less than 40% of NGOs had an online presence. So they had no website, nothing, right? Or you know, maybe they were just a Facebook fan page. And out of 8,000 registered organizations in Klang Valley, only 4% of them were actively recruiting volunteers. So this was the real problem. And what the story kind of wraps up with is it says, yes, we built a product, and yes, we put it out to the world. No, we did not solve the right problem, right? We knew that a website is a good solution for volunteers looking to find volunteering opportunities, but it is the wrong problem to solve, because that is, yes, it is a problem, but the real problem is we need to serve NGO needs, right? And without this, there's no product. And there's no successful product anyway. And so what we had to do is we had to actually spend some time redesigning the platform, and money as well, to make sure that we could serve NGO needs. And so the question for you guys, and I think a lot of us, as we have, how many of you guys have ideas for startups you want to do? No one? Okay, that's okay. When you will have that idea, you're going to be super excited about it, and you're going to go, okay, let's go and build it. And the challenge, or the problem with that, is that we go out and build these ideas, but actually we're solving the wrong problem in many cases. And so we need to take a step back after we come up with an idea for a solution, and then work on the problem or validate the problem. So today, this number needs to be updated, but we have 50,000 registered volunteers on Do Something Good. We've had super volunteers. So basically, these are volunteers that manage volunteering opportunities on behalf of NGOs. So that's kind of how we solve that problem. It's a working platform, but we made a lot of modifications to it along the way. Modifications which I wish we had made at the beginning had we done proper validation. And that's what I'm going to show you guys today a little bit about. Now, the first thing I want to do is I want to ask you guys a question. Any of you have had to start up a project so far in university? Like, I don't know, maybe you've had an entrepreneurship project that you've had to start up? And so what's the first, so once you've got the idea, what's the first thing that you do, what's the first thing that you do once you have the idea? Brainstorm research. What kind of research? Whether there are previous attempts for the product, okay.
If there's a better solution for it, and if there is, can we work on that solution okay. and make it better?
Yeah. And then what else? After that research, what do you do? What's that?
Analyze.
The design, okay. And then after that?
Feedback from people.
So you probably did. Did you guys do market research?
Surveys.
Right. How did you do your surveys? Google.
Facebook.
Okay. Cool. So what I want to do is I'm going to ask you guys, I'm going to give you guys a task, and we're going to spend 2 minutes doing it. Let me just see where this room cuts in half. I think it cuts in half about here. Yeah. Maybe not. Damn it. Okay, so it cuts in half. Let's say we're going to cut it in half here. All of you guys right here, including your table, you guys are group one. You and everyone behind are group two. Okay? All right. So actually, I definitely haven't cut this in half. From here, cut down across this line. Okay, group one and group two. All right, so what we're going to do is, what I'm going to do is, group one, you guys have, you guys are starting up a power bank selling business, okay? So here on campus, you are selling power banks to students. You're selling them at market price. They're just like normal power banks, okay? Now, I want you to go and do market research in group two to find out who would buy a power bank, okay? Who would buy a power bank? And so what you're going to do is you're just going to ask one person, okay? So you're just going to find one person and you're just going to ask them, would they buy, you find out whether they would buy a power bank. And so group two, you guys only answer once, okay? I only want you guys to talk to one person. Got it? So you guys ask, and you guys find other people here, you know, find one person, find out whether they would be willing to buy a power bank. Got it? Okay, we're going to take 60 seconds. Let's go. Once you're done, have a seat.
I'd love to see in pictures.
All right, you guys should be done now. Have a seat, have a seat. Okay, so group one, how many of you found someone who would be willing to buy a power bank? Okay, let me count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 10, huh? No one else. Okay, all right, we got 10. What did you guys ask them, by the way?
What would stand out for you? What would make them consider buying the power bank?
Okay.
And the first answer would be light, capacity, attractiveness, okay. Price, and yeah, that's all.
All right. Anyone else have anything else?
I was told graffiti and decorations to.
You got nice graffiti. So you guys actually went a step further and you found out why would people buy a power bank, right? Yeah, that's cool. But you asked them, right? Like, would they buy one? Yes. Okay. Well, you wanted to add something?
Yeah, I asked them how long should the last and all that.
How long should it last? Okay. Anything else from this side? No? Okay. Now for everyone in group two, I want you to think, so there are power banks upstairs, right? And I don't know, they're selling for 80, maybe 100 bucks, 60 bucks, I don't know. If I were to come to you with a power bank right now, or like today, and try to sell it to you, would you actually buy it? How many of you would actually buy it? 0. 1. All right. So, anyone see any problems with this? People are not ready. Interesting. Well, so anything else? I think that's true, by the way. Yeah. They already have it, right? So what just happened is your market research just told you that there are 10 power banks in the market, right? You have there's 10 people want to buy power banks, and then when we actually go out and look at what's the actual demand, it's 1. So basically, the market research overestimated the power bank demand by 10 times, by an order of magnitude. Bit of a problem, right? And this is the key problem with market research, actually. So a lot of people have built startups and asked people like, would you guys like, okay, wait, I'll give you, well, okay, so they asked, would you guys like, this particular service at some point? And they'd be like, yeah, it sounds like a good idea, right? And so people overestimate, of course, whether or not they're going to buy something, or they answer in ways that because they don't want to be mean to you, they're like, yeah, sounds like your startup for peanut delivery is a good idea, and then you build a million ringgit peanut delivery company, and it's like, hey, no one actually wants peanut delivery, but all these people told me yes, and this is a big reason why startups fail. Right, because they trusted market research, which actually at the end of the day it was crap data. It wasn't actually trustworthy market research. And so a little bit of what we're doing today is to say like, okay, well, how can we actually get real information? So here's my challenge to you. So group two, and this is where I'm hoping that roughly group two is the same size as group one. So group two, now you guys have this assignment, or this tougher assignment really, which is to find out whether people in group one, someone in group one would buy a healthy food delivery service to Taylor's campus. So you've got this company. You deliver healthy food to Taylor, lunch for Taylor's to Taylor's campus. You want to find out if people would actually order it. But, and here's the big but, you cannot directly ask them whether they would order it. So you can ask questions around the, you know, healthy food and delivery of food maybe, but you cannot ask them, would you, you know, order healthy food from me today, or something like that. Got it? So you can ask questions around it, but you can't ask directly that question. This one's going to take a little bit longer. I'm going to give you guys about 3 minutes for it. Any questions? All right, so again, find one person in group one and then query them on this healthy food delivery service. People did you find, do you think would actually order your service if you were to sell it to them? Zero. One, two, three, four, five. Wait, wait, okay, let me count properly. Put up all your hands. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. Okay, interesting. Ten again. And now group one. Oops, sorry. Group one, you can order healthy food tomorrow for your lunch. How many of you are going to do it? Put up your hands. Okay. Monday, you can do it. How many of you would actually do it? Aren't you in group two? All right, one, two. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. That's interesting. It is, but what's interesting is that the group 2 underestimated the demand. Super interesting. So I want to ask group 2, what kinds of questions did you ask if not to directly ask them, would they buy? Are you sick of Taylor's food? Okay, what else?
Their diet.
Their diet? And what would you look for if you asked that?
You kind of get like a mental image of what kind of food they like, whether they're going for the cost of it or just healthy.
Whether they go for cost or for healthy. Yeah. That's a good one. That's a really good strategy. Anything else? What else have you guys asked? Or how else did you ask? What did they have for lunch? Okay. And what does that tell you? Did you find someone who was ordering healthy food?
I can't get any of the
definite answer.
You can't get any. See, that what I had for lunch today might not be an accurate representation, I feel. Yeah. But that's an interesting question. I think if someone ate healthy, it at least shows you that they're willing to eat healthy, right? But it doesn't disprove it either.
It's an indirect approach, though.
Yeah, exactly. Any other question strategies that are interesting? Okay, so these were pretty good ones. Now let's move to the second piece of it, which is I want to tell you guys a story about a startup called Puppy Match. It is cute, isn't it? And the entrepreneurs behind it were kind of cute as well. In their personality. And so Puppy Match was a startup in New York. And what it was intended to do, or what the idea behind it was, is that people who had dogs had interests in common. So they would want to date each other. So it was a dating service for people who had dogs. Not only that, but they also wanted their dogs to breed with each other. So there's like dog dating and there's human dating as part of this. And so they called this web platform Puppy Match, and this is what they wanted to build. And the entrepreneurs were totally serious about this, right? Now, this is the thing about entrepreneurs. You can never tell them that they have a bad idea because they just won't believe you. At least, you know, the ones that are committed to their idea, because they're like, no, I really think this is going to work. They have to find out for themselves whether their idea is bad or it's good. And so what happened in this, they went through a lean startup workshop. And what happened is the first day they were told, okay, go and pitch your idea to a bunch of people in Central Park. So they said, okay, we're going to pitch to 50 people in Central Park. So they went to Central Park. They said, okay, we've got this dog dating service, and it's, you know, $19.99 or whatever. You sign up for 3 months, and you find other people who have dogs, and maybe your dogs can have babies. if you're lucky. So they did that. And out of 50 people, any guesses how many people said yes? A little bit better than that. 7 people said yes. And it's New York, so a lot of different kinds of personalities there. 7 people said yes, and 6 of them were guys. So they're like, this might not work as a dating service. At least not the dating service that we were thinking about, anyway. So they knew, like, without building. So these guys were going to build the website, right, and spend all this money launching Puppy Match. But actually, just in an afternoon, they found out whether this was a good idea or not. And the question they asked, so they came back, and what they did though, as they were talking to these people, is they asked them those indirect questions, those kind of questions that group two you guys were asking, right? So first they did the pitch, and they said, "Would you buy this thing?" And someone said no. And it's like, okay, well, you know, do you have other problems with your dog that you're looking to solve? And so they would uncover other kinds of things about these people as they were talking to them. For example, some people said, well, yeah, it's really hard for me to schedule play dates for my dogs. So play dates, you know, I want my dog to play with other dogs. That's the idea. And so they came back and they're like, well, why don't we build a business around that instead? This is called a pivot. So the idea behind a pivot in startups is we started with one customer and one problem and a solution, and then we decided to change one of these things. So in this case, the customer is the same. The problem and their problem is different, though. They want to schedule play dates for their dogs. And their solution is a little bit different as well. And so they went to another park in New York, and they asked 30 people whether they would schedule a play date with their dog tomorrow. Now, this is very important, right? They didn't say, would you like to schedule a play date with your dog at some point in the future? Why? Why would they not say that or ask that? It's too vague, yeah. So, like, that's the kind of question that's going to get you crap data in your market survey, right? It's like, yeah, sure, maybe I'll do it in 3 years. You need customers now, right, if you're a startup. So what they said is, you know, would you schedule a committal question? Would you schedule a play date with your dog tomorrow? And if they said yes, they asked for an email address. So out of 30 people, 20 said yes, and 19 gave email addresses. So that was pretty good, right? So that sounds like a viable startup. So over a weekend, they discovered that they had a wrong idea, and then they pivoted to a good idea. And this is the kind of process that you'll want to go through for your own startups. And the reason that we do this is because it used to be that we'd start actually building things, right? Because it used to be that technology risk, i.e. the risk that we would build something and it wouldn't work, was the biggest risk in building a new company. That, you know, we set up this factory, we, I don't know, design this new phone, and that the technology might not exist for it. But today, actually, most startups don't fail for this reason, right? We know how to build all of these things. We're pretty good at doing it. Or at least China is now, and now the issue is market risk, right? So the question is, do people actually want this thing that I am selling? And so what you want to focus on in the early stages of whatever startup project you're doing is how do I get rid of this market risk? How do I test it out? So this is kind of the old model where, you know, some smart, really smart person, we talk to experts, you know, those experts that told us not to do something good. We talk to an expert, and then they decide what's the smart thing to do, and then we build it, and then we hope that people want it. This is the old model. We're kind of getting rid of that. We're also getting rid of market research because of these three, I would say, inalienable truths, at least from our perspective, about startups. And so here's the first one. Startups are basically like a game, and in this game, you have to find a scalable and repeatable business model before you run out of money. So the way a startup works is, you know, you pitch an idea to an investor. Investor says, okay, great, here's $500,000. That will power your startup for 6 months. You better find your customers, and you better find a customer base that you can repeatedly tap to make money from in that 6 months. If you find your customer base in 9 months, your company doesn't exist anymore and it doesn't matter, right? You're dead in this game. So this is why speed is so important for startups, is because you have to find out what's repeatable and scalable. So repeatable is that I can keep on selling the same product over and over again. Scalable means that I can go for a very big market, right? Any questions about this? No? Okay. Second inalienable truth is that your first idea probably won't be your best one, or it probably won't be the idea behind your startup. So we see a lot of startups, and we see the, you know, the end product that they came up with, but what we don't see in their success is all of the different products that they tried and failed, right? So from our perspective as consumers, or as people who are reading stuff on the internet or whatever, we only see this, we don't see all of this. Anyone know what PayPal was as they initially started? What were they? No, actually, no. I like that. what were they when they first started? Do you know? They were a. It was just a random guess. Okay, PayPal was the lamest idea in the world when they first started. Basically, this was the days when we had personal digital assistants. PDAs are basically like smartphones without the phone part. So it's just a little computer, and. And basically, they were like, oh, well, you know, let's say you go to a restaurant with a friend of yours, and your friend paid the bill. Well, you can use your infrared port on your PDA to beam the money, right? And it's like, okay, this is an idea that will only work in Silicon Valley, basically. And they realized that pretty quickly. And the good news is, because they realized it pretty quickly, they managed to pivot their business model. So what happened was, they said, well, you know what? People don't really care for this app that we created. So what we're going to do is we're going to take all of the security software that we've built for that, and we're going to actually move it to online payments instead. Anyone knows how much PayPal was bought for? eBay bought PayPal a couple years later for, if I'm not mistaken, $1.5 billion US. And so now you guys probably know. Do you guys know about the PayPal Mafia? Do you know Elon Musk? You know Elon Musk. Engineering students, come on, guys. Right? So who doesn't want to be Elon Musk? Although he's gaining a lot of weight lately. Elon Musk was part of the PayPal Mafia. So he was one of the core group of people who founded PayPal, made a crap load of money, and then built his own companies. Peter Thiel was another guy behind the PayPal Mafia. And so they all went on and they did very successful startups after selling out PayPal. Good thing they figured out that initial idea was not a very good one. YouTube. Anyone know what YouTube started off as? In a garage, yes. It was a different product than it is today, though. Yes? Exactly. It was a video dating website. Good thing they changed too. otherwise, YouTube would be a pretty awkward place to hang out on. Instagram. Instagram did not start off as Instagram is today. What's that? No. It was an app. It was an app when they started. So Instagram was an app. It was called Bourbon. And the idea was that it was kind of like Foursquare. I don't know if you guys use or know Foursquare. Okay. So I sometimes feel like Foursquare is a little bit old. So I'm like, woo. Because we used to check in on Foursquare. You can't do that anymore. Now Swarm, yeah. So anyway, it was like Foursquare, and you'd take a photo of where you were, and you'd post it, and they'd be like, oh, I'm at this cafe or whatever, right? So it started off as that, and actually, like, people didn't really like it. It was too complicated to use. I had too many features, too many buttons. It was slow. And so eventually what they did is they realized, actually, the only feature that people like are these is the picture-taking feature, right? And so they said, well, let's just focus on that. And build an app out of that. And so they built Instagram 13 months after they founded it. It was a huge success. Facebook bought it for some ridiculous number of billions of dollars. Anyone remember what it was? It was 1 billion. Yeah, 13 months. I mean, I've never made so much money in 13 months. I wish I could, right? 13 months. Two babies, basically, is the time. So the third inalienable truth around startups for us is that actually building stuff is the least efficient way to spend your money at the beginning. Why? What's that? It's too much to invest, yeah, but why? What's your goal in the early stages of your startup? Market share? Not quite. I heard something else. Securing customers? Okay. What else? Remember what I said in the first point, right? What's that? You're trying to attract investment? Yeah. It's like a game. Okay. And? You guys are almost there. Mm-hmm. I have to get to this repeatable and scale. So, what I'm trying to do as a startup, my single most important goal in the early stages of my startup is to find the scalable and repeatable business model, which means it's a search process. And so where I put my money is whatever is the most efficient way for me to find that. And usually it's not building, at least not in the early stages. Building Puppy Match was the least efficient way of finding out whether people wanted puppy dating, right? It was actually way more efficient for them to go and try to manually sell it to people in the park. And so this is kind of the third one. It's that building is the least efficient way to do it. And so what we do in Lean Startup is we try to actually skip this kind of build and code part as much as possible. And we just kind of have ideas and we go and measure whether they're effective, and then we try to loop back in here. And so this whole cycle here for a product might take 6 months to a year. But under Lean Startup, you can do it in 5 days to 2 weeks, right? Or you can even faster, like these Puppy Match guys did it in a weekend, right? But they got some initial validation around that. And so we're no longer looking at experts. We're looking at building an evidence-based startup, right? So you guys have done a bunch of science courses, and obviously you appreciate the value of evidence and the value of data. And the weird thing is that the way that we build startups today is the same way that medicine was practiced, you know, pre-1800s. So I don't know if you guys know this, but like bloodletting. Any of you guys heard of bloodletting? What's that? No. So bloodletting was a common medical practice before 1836. And the idea was if you got sick, if you had a cold or something like that, it's because there were bad humors in your blood. And so they drain your blood. Yeah, fun stuff. It's good not to be born in the 1830s. Until basically a French physician, Pierre-Louis, conducted the first clinical trials. It's almost crazy when you think about how recent evidence-based medicine is, right? It's like, oh my God, what were people practicing medicine based on before? But that's still how we build startups. Like, people are like, oh yeah, I think this is a good idea. Let's go do it, right? It's not evidence-based. And so sadly, this is a photo of George Washington. George Washington had a sore throat, and he had 5 pints of blood let from him because that's what the experts said to do, and he died 3 days later from a sore throat. So that's kind of the thing. And so your job as you build your crowdfunding campaign, as you build your startup, is to be this kind of a combination between a salesman and a scientist. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to test you guys out and see how ready you are for this. So I've got a pattern in my head of numbers. It's 2, 4, 8. All right? So these are, I'm going to give you, that's my number sample that fits my pattern in my head. Now I'm going to ask you guys, give me 3 numbers. You can test the pattern with me, right? All you can do, you just give me 3 numbers to test the pattern, and I will tell you yes or no whether it fits the pattern. And then you can guess the pattern. Got it? We're all clear here? Okay, cool. All right, so 2, 4, 8, what are your guesses? 16? You have to give me 3 numbers. So you have to give me 3 numbers to test the pattern. 16, 32, 64, yeah. What else? Yeah. Any other guesses? Any guesses as to what the pattern is? So what's my pattern? Power of 2? Nope. What's that? Adding the same number? Nope. You want to test some more numbers with me? I'm sorry? 3, 9, 27. Yep, that works. So what could the pattern be? Sorry? It's a series. I mean, is it a series? The pattern is not a series itself, right? The pattern will output a series of numbers for you. It's not a Taylor in series, no. Any other guesses as to what the pattern might be, or you want to throw some numbers at me? It's actually a very simple pattern. No. That does not fit the pattern. It is ascending. What's that? Is it a, what's, so what's your pattern? Is this a pattern guess, or is this?
It's something that you can use A plus N minus 1 B.
A plus N minus 1 E.
D.
D. So what does the D stand for?
D stands for 4 divided by 2.
That works, but it's not my pattern.
Yeah, everybody.
8, 4, 16, 24. Yes, that works. So guess is 4, 1, 4 to the power of 1, 4 to the power of 2. It's not my pattern. Okay, I'll give it to you guys. This guy's going to make us stand here and try to guess his pattern. My pattern is just a sequence of increasingly large numbers. Yeah. So. What's the core principle behind the scientific method? Observation, okay, and? What do I do with a hypothesis? I test it to do what? You cannot validate a hypothesis. Right, so if I say, if my hypothesis is that this pen will fall, right? It's a test gravity. I'm going to test gravity. I cannot prove that it will fall every time, right? It's not possible to experimentally prove that something will happen forever. So we cannot prove hypotheses, at least in experimental sense, we can't. We can only disprove them. We disprove hypotheses. In science, we only disprove hypotheses. We cannot prove them. And so gravity is a theory that has yet to be disproven, right? Because we have some pretty damn good evidence for it. And no one has seen anything, no one has dropped the pen and it hasn't dropped. So if someone tried to drop the pen and it didn't drop, all of physics would be like, holy shit. That's interesting, and that could disprove gravity, or at least our understanding of it. So what you guys should have been doing to test out my pattern is to try to disprove it, right? You kept on asking me questions that were based on your understanding of it to prove whether you were right, right? And you were right in some cases, but then in order to actually get the right answer, you have to disprove it. So you have to find out what are all of the different things that are wrong. And so in the startup space, what you guys are gonna end up doing is you're gonna ask a lot of people, whether they want your product. You're gonna try to get confirming evidence. But what you're really trying to do, if you're doing your evidence-based startup in a good way, is you actually have to get disconfirming evidence. You want to disprove certain ideas that you have about how about your product or your demand for your product or whatever it is. And so here's how we do it. For some reason these don't show up. So what we do is we have a customer problem solution hypothesis. And so you can just think of these as three post-it notes. I'm just going to start with customer and problem. So my customer could be Taylor students. I think that Taylor students have a problem of Taylor's food sucks. I'll pick out a couple of core assumptions behind that, right? So maybe my core assumptions are price matters. They all have lunch at the campus, and they like vegetarian food. Which one do you think is my riskiest assumption? They like vegetarian food, right? Okay, so then what I'll do is I'll go and test this, right? And I'll say, okay, well, what's the least, I'll set a criterion for this, and I'll say, what's the weakest test result that I'm willing to accept for this? And I'll say half of the people I ask, they have to say yes. If half of the people I ask say, yes, I like vegetarian food, I'm going to take this one to be true. In other words, I'm going to take this to mean that there is a sufficiently large market around this. And so what we'll do is we will actually go and test the riskiest assumption. We'll pick out the risky assumptions and we'll test that one. And if that one's validated, then we'll test the next riskiest assumption. If it's invalidated, we need to switch customer problem, right? We need to switch one of those things. That's the pivot. That's the pivot that you saw with PayPal as they were changing what they were doing. So I'll give you guys an example. This one's by a guy called Trevor Owens. He was looking at, could I start a Vespa rental service or a Vespa selling service in New York? And so his customer wanted to talk to Vespa buyers and understand why they were buying Vespas. So his customer is Vespa buyers. His assumption, the problem that he thinks that they're trying to solve is oil is bad. So they want to live in a more environmentally friendly way, and that's why they're buying a Vespa. Couple of core assumptions around this: price matters, they're getting a ride to get around, and they care about the environment. And so he decided, I think the care about the environment is the riskiest assumption here, so he set up an experiment. Let's say you guys wanted to talk to Vespa buyers, where would you go? Thoughts? To the beach? Hipster cafe, sounds like a good one. Starbucks is not a hipster cafe. Any other ideas? Hard Rock Cafe. Hard Rock Cafe? Aren't they more like Harley Davidson guys? Imagine like riding up to Hard Rock Cafe in your Vespa. Get a good stares there. Any other thoughts? Where do I find Vespa buyers? Huh? Art studio. Yeah, so I think those are all good answers. Trevor found a really efficient answer. His was online. And so what he did is he posted a Craigslist ad. Craigslist is like the American version of Lelong. And basically said, hey, I've got a Vespa to sell. Here's a photo. He didn't have a Vespa to sell. Here's a photo. Here's the phone number. Call me. And so he said, I'm going to talk to 20 people. And he's going to say, I'm going to vow this. For me, this assumption is valid. There's a market for environmentally friendly Vespa buyers if one out of the 20 tell me that they care about the environment. So let's say you're doing these phone calls. So people are now calling you, right? Vespa buyers are calling you. Wow. You know, that's amazing kind of market validation. You don't even have to go find people. They're calling you and they're saying, hey, tell me about your Vespa, right? And it's like, ah. And so what do you ask them to find out whether they care about the environment? How do you commute now? Okay. How would that tell you about whether they care about the environment? So like if a guy has a Hummer and he's using that, it disproves the environmental hypothesis, right? That's a good one. What else could you ask? It's a tough one though, like that won't give you definitive answers, right? Yeah. What else could you ask? Right? Yeah. So the suggestion here is the best thing, in the middle of the conversation, you say, you know, one of the great things about a Vespa is the fuel economy. And if he agrees with you, then you kind of get an idea. What do you guys think about that? It's too vague. I think it's okay. It's not vague. I don't think that's the issue. Yeah, it could just be like, but I don't really care. it could be one. Anything else? Any other thoughts, guys? Ask them about environmental issues. That could be. So I just want to return to this question because I think it's an interesting example. So one of the things is, of course, if fuel economy is your interest, it could also be a financial thing, right? So that could be one. And two is when people agree, when people feel like they have to agree with you, again, you're kind of pulling out some of this weak data that we were talking about earlier. What Trevor Owens did is much simpler than what all of you guys were thinking about. He just was like, oh, so why are you buying a Vespa? Right? And they told their stories, right? And people were like, I'm buying a Vespa because my wife has one and I don't like to feel left out. Okay. And then another guy was like, oh, I'm buying a Vespa because I just want to wear a skinny tie and drive a Vespa, you know? Another guy was some other reason and so on and so forth. And at the end of it, after 20 calls, no one mentioned the environment as a reason for them to buy a Vespa, right? And so for him, this disproved it, right? And you really want, so if you're testing something like this, you really want people to mention it to you. Like, if you ask that question, right? If they care about the environment, but it's not the reason they're buying a Vespa, this is not a good selling point. Because it's like, yeah, I kind of care about the environment, but, you know, it's not going to influence my purchasing decision, basically. It's definitely not at the front of my mind when I'm making that. So basically, that this guy disproven. So what he's going to need to do now is he either needs to change his customer group, or he needs to change, what's the problem they're trying to solve. Now you guys don't yet have things that you're gonna crowdfund for, right? Not yet, huh? Okay. So what we're gonna do now for the rest of today, as we work on this sort of building your first experiment, is I need a product idea. What's that? You have a product idea? Okay, cool. So we're going to get a product idea, and you guys will all come up with ideas on how to validate this. What's your product idea?
It was actually our innovation project 2 semesters ago. We came up with a zip idea where it can't be punctured in, so it can be attached to the luggage bag.
A zip that can't be punctured.
With a pen or anything sharp.
With a pen. And you attach it to the luggage bag?
With the luggage bag. So you don't have to use safety codes or any other padlocks just to lock your bag.
Right, okay. So is it part of your luggage bag, or is it something you add on top of it?
Part of your luggage bag.
It's part of it. So it's manufactured in with your bag. And so so that's the product. I don't know, what do you guys think? Do you guys want to do that one? You want to do something else? Up to you guys, really. It's up to you. Okay, you've got an idea.
What if we provide a golf buggy service, okay, from the food court area upstairs to DK Senza?
I'm sorry, what?
Like currently, the student parking, most of them park illegally and everything, although there's ample of parking at the new building, but it's like a 5-minute walk. So if we can provide the service that ferries students from the food court to there.
Okay. Okay, golf buggy service. Any other ideas? This is not about picking necessarily an idea that you like. It's just about, you know, what is the first experiment that we're going to run. Any other ideas? Yeah, okay.
How about valet parking for the campus?
Valet parking for the campus. All right. I wonder why that hasn't been done already. All right, anything else? All right, so let's get an idea of which one you guys want to do. So the first one, the first one we have is the secure zip for bags. If you want to do that, put up your hand. Okay. Second one is the golf buggy service. If you want to do that, put up your hand. Got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. Okay, 14. Valet parking. If you want to do that, put up your hand. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Okay, yeah. So valet parking wins. All right. So now what I want you guys to do is I want you to brainstorm. Let's say your table is your group. So you're going to need to join a table. You can join these guys. Your table is your. Although we have some you have some individual people up there. You know, if you're not in a group, just join some people in front of you. Hold on. Don't move anywhere yet. I haven't told you what to do. you're going to need to brainstorm a customer. So who's the customer that you're thinking about? And I want you to be as specific as possible. So I don't want you to be like, oh, Taylor students, right? I don't think all Taylor students will use this. Who do you think is a specific segment of Taylor students who would use this? What's the problem that they're trying to solve? You know what the solution is. Think about some core assumptions behind it, okay? So we're gonna take about 7 minutes and write these down, right? So what do I think is the customer? If you can think of several customer segments that would use this, that are different customer segments, that would be great. What's the problem that they're trying to solve? It's not necessarily transport, right? It could be safety, it could be something else. And then what are some of the core assumptions behind this? Any questions about this so far? We good? All right, let's do this.
Hello, definitely, how are you?
Definitely not the, what do you call them? Not the lecturers, because they have their own private practice.
Definitely.
So this drives.
We need a call.
Yeah, to find about the core assumptions. Customers shouldn't be too general. Like you said, like Taylor students, it has to be more specific than that. Because like not all Taylor students
are ready. Who are Taylor students?
Yeah, they have to park at the parking.
So make sure you have that, and then like.
Who are fat Taylor students that can't walk?
The time it takes to find a parking spot, they want to get from me.
I've been here anyway for this.
Oops, sorry.
Yeah, it's this one.
If someone offers you a valet service, for example, what problem for you does that solve?
Hopefully people find the parking space.
Yeah, so that's your problem.
Yeah.
Just pick one, you just pick out one, what's the biggest problem?
Not necessarily the valet.
So look, if you want to do another, if you want to create an experiment with another product or service, that's fine. But all I need you guys to do is put down the customer segment. What do you think is a customer segment? Or what do you, there are several customer segments, maybe what do you think they are? What's the problem they're trying to solve? And what are the core assumptions behind that? So like, things that I think are actually important, and if this is not true, then this whole thing fails, right? So I need you guys to write that down, because we're going to use it a little bit later as we build the experiment. You got one. Okay, that's fine. And then four assumptions? Four assumptions. Okay, your four assumptions. So core assumption is like any assumption that's behind this, like we think this is really important for this, and if this wasn't true, then this whole thing fails. Alright? So you've got your customer. So what are different groups of people who I think would buy or use this service? Sorry? You want to be as specific as possible. So like, it's not all Taylor students, maybe it's only certain kinds of Taylor students that would use it. Your problem, so what's the problem you're trying to solve for them with this value? Just pick one out. And then the last piece is, what are your core assumptions? So you saw our Vivesco example, we've got like the price matters and the oil is bad and so on and so forth. So for something is anything that is really important for this, like if this turns out to be false, then our whole thing comes crashing down.
What we're gonna do is, okay, so you guys have picked your riskiest assumptions. I wanna ask you guys, like, what were your riskiest assumptions? People trusting you with their cars, that's a damn good one, right? Yeah. Anything? What's that? Willingness to customers to pay. That's the thing you wanna test, probably. Do you have a price assumption behind that or something like that? Right. Okay. So it has to be less than $25, or it has to be more convenient than getting your car unclamped, because that could be a bit of a pain as well. Because it has to be less than $25. But actually, if you spend more than $100 on valet service, then obviously you're not doing it for price, right? You're not doing it to save money. It's easy to do. Valet should be less than $100, right? If price matters to your customer.
Yeah, $100 a whole month. Club.
Your valet service has to be damn cheap.
I wanted to charge you $50 for one whether I rally back with you. Brother, you want penny?
Yeah, so I mean, this is interesting. This is very interesting. How many of you guys had price assumptions? How many of you guys have price matters in your core assumptions? Yeah, okay. So if that core assumption turns out to be true, your business is going to have some serious problems, right? Because it's hard to, it's hard to valet park your car for 20 days and spend less than $100. okay. Anyone came up, had alternative ideas about, anyone thinks that their model isn't sensitive to price? Yeah. Right, so in this case, you think that one of the reasons that people would use this valet service is for social status. It's like, oh yeah, looks good that I'm using this valet service. Yeah, I just dropped my car off at the roundabout. let me call the valet to get my car back. So you have to be able to show it off in order for that to be true. But maybe people would be willing to spend more than $100, right? That's a good one, interesting. Anything else? Very cool. All right, so next thing we're going to do is, so you guys have your riskiest assumptions. Next thing we're going to do is we're going to build an experiment, but I want to talk to you guys a little bit about, we have, I have 2 hours, is it? Okay, so we got 15 more minutes. So we're going to do experiments in less than 15 minutes. Important, there are three stages of validation. The first stage is your problem validation. So this is, we go in, when we first start a company, or we look at a new product, we don't even ask people about the product itself. We just ask people about the problem. Like the questions that you guys were doing before, it's like, why are you buying a Vespa? The questions about the healthy food service. So we just ask people, like, what's the what are problems that they're having in this space? You know, the Taylor's food, I'm so tired of it, I keep having the same thing over and over again. So first we validate the problem. If the problem turns out to be true, then we move on to validating the solution. So then I actually start pitching to you a solution. I say, okay, I've got this product, it's healthy food, would you order it, would you deliver it? And then the last piece is, and this is important, and sometimes people forget this, is that even if you have the right problem, even if you have the right solution, your business can still fail. Why? Marketing, exactly. So if your cost, so have you guys, I don't know if you guys have looked at this whole idea of like the cost of user acquisition. So in a company, when you start marketing, you have to look at, the major question in marketing is, what's the cost for me to acquire one user, right? And so you run online ads and it'll be like, okay, I have to spend 200 ringgit on ads to acquire one user. If that's the case, and my user spends less than 200 ringgit with me, my business is not going to work, right? The customer lifetime value has to, at least, the lifetime value of having that customer with me has to be at least more than 200 ringgit. Otherwise, I'm losing money on every user that I'm registering. And so funnel validation is the idea that I actually need to be able to market this service in a way that's cost effective for me to actually have a successful business. Even if I have the right product, even if I have the right solution, if I have no way of marketing it to people, I do not have a business. I do not have a scalable business. I might have a repeatable business, but I can't scale it because I can't market it. Cool? So there are three types of experiments that you can run in Lean Startup. And these are the three types. So the first one is exploration. So this is kind of, we go far and wide. This is kind of what you guys already did a little bit of. And we've tried to find out what's the problem, what are these guys thinking about as issues that they're facing. Pain points. We like to talk about pain points. The pitch is what Puppy Match did. So they went out to the park and they said, would you buy this, would you subscribe to this dating service? Concierge is, I actually deliver the service for you. I haven't built the service maybe at the back end, but I actually deliver. So if you guys come and if I want to test this ordering service and people are and I want to see, like, can I really, really do this? I'm not going to buy a bunch of trucks and do it, right? I'm going to actually take orders from Taylor's campus and I'm going to personally deliver them. That's concierge. And that's not what my business will look like when it's scaled up, but that's how I can test it, concierge style. So interviews, there are a couple of things. I'm going to just add a couple of things to this. One of the most important questions in interviews is you want to know how far someone has gone to try to solve a problem, right? So you don't just want to know whether it's a problem for them. You want to know, like, have they spent money trying to solve this problem? Are they, hacking things to try to solve this problem? All of this, these are really great indicators that this is a real problem that they're facing. And the second thing we try to do is we try to identify different segments. So some people might use the valet service because it makes them look cool. Some people might use the valet service because they're worried about safety. These are two different customer segments. You can test them both separately. Product pitch. Here the important part is I'm pitching the product to you in exchange for some kind of currency. Now, currency doesn't have to be money. So we look at, I'll give you an example. So we did a workshop, and one of the companies in this Lean Startup workshop was like, I want to do this service where we can test all of these diseases that you might potentially have based on your hair. So we get a hair follicle, and we run the test based on that, and then we mail you back the results. So we're like, okay, cool. So then go try to sell it. So they went to a LRT station and they talked to people and they actually just made a little board and it shows, okay, here's the process. Basically it starts here, we'll do the test, we can test you for 20,000 different diseases, so on and so forth. The end of it though is how do they check whether people actually are interested in it, is they ask for them to give a hair. Right? That's the currency in that case. So you want people to put some effort. If you really want to have a confirmed research result, you want people to put some effort towards it. Sometimes we ask for money, right? And they'll give us money. But if we don't have the product yet, then we need to give it back. And we just need to say, hey, thanks very much. I'm trying to do research to find out whether this is a real product. And so I thank you very much for your feedback. I'm going to give you back your money, though, because our product isn't ready yet. So we do that. Outright adoption is actually buying it. So we did another Lean Startup workshop in a university. The students decided that one of the groups of students decided that the problem that they wanted to solve was printing. So let me ask you guys this: what time do you usually finish your papers the day before they're due? 2 a.m., right? And so you know the only time a dorm room looks like this in university is about 3 a.m., right? when people are furiously working on their papers, which are due at what time the next morning? 8 a.m. What time does a print shop open? 10. Problem, right? So these students were like, we're going to set up a 24-hour print service. And they did. And basically, what they did is they went around campus. We said, okay, test it. So they went around campus and they convinced people to prepay for the print service. So they collected like 240 ringgit. They didn't have a printer. they didn't have a printer, but 240 ringgit is enough to go buy a printer to run a 24-hour print service. So that's what they did. Cool thing. So you want to look at what people do more importantly than what people say. So four things can happen in your validation. One is you meet your success criterion. So again, this is very important. Before you run your experiment, I'm going to talk to 20 people, 10 of them have to say yes. Or I'm going to talk to 50 people, I want 20 of them to say yes. Set a number around that as to what you expect. So you can meet the success criterion, great. Then what you're going to do is, what do you do after you meet your success criterion? You move forward to your next riskiest assumption. Basically, you want to clear out all those risky assumptions so that you're certain that whatever you're going to do is going to succeed. Two is you've got some kind of signal, right? So like you think back to Puppy Match. What happened is they went out to the park and the guy said no to their service. But then as they started asking questions around, they got a signal. And it's like, oh, maybe there's something in this play date thing, right? So they got a signal that helped them pivot. Foaming at the mouth. Ideal type of customer, right? They're like, oh my God, I've been looking for this for years. I have spent all this money trying to fix this problem and I haven't been able to fix it. So you locate these customers, this is super important. You wanna identify more clearly what's that segment. What do all these people who are foaming at the mouth have in common? How can I find more of them? And the fourth one is you failed, but you learned, right? And so then you pivot. You change your customer, you change your solution segment, and then you run a new test. Around either of those. So what a lot of people don't know is most startups are actually built with the first 100 users or the first 1,000 users. Those are the most important users for you. And what you're gonna do is as you build your startup, because they're passionate about your product, they will go and spread it to other people. People who don't really care about, if your customer base is like people who are like, not so interested in your startup will never scale. Because those people are not going to advocate it to other people. So you want those foaming at the mouth customers. So we call them cookie monsters. And usually they have the problem, they're aware they have the problem, they're searching for a solution, they've hacked a solution, they've spent money on it. This is kind of what we call a cookie monster. Last one I want to talk about is concierge. So this is actually delivering the value of your solution to your customers. You guys probably haven't heard of the search engine. It's called Aardvark. It was bought by Google for $200 million. What it did is it allowed people to ask opinion questions. So like, what's the best Android phone? Or what's the best restaurant in Kales? Things like that. And it's an opinion search engine, so it's designed to return opinions rather than facts. Now, the thing is, the guys who started this search engine were like, we don't really know what kinds of searches people are going to do. So what they did is, instead of actually building all the technology behind that to answer that, they're just like, we're just going to have people answer those questions. So what would happen is, you'd put in a search, and you'd have to wait for a little bit, and then there's a real person trying to finally answer to your question, and then they send the answer back, right? And when Google had bought them, that's still what they were doing. They hadn't built any technology. They had just built a service to get for people to get answers to questions from other real people. So that's an example of a concierge test. They didn't build all the technology behind it. They just did it. They hacked it. They did it manually. Cheryl, okay. This is, you guys know Zappos? Zappos, what does Zappos do? They sell shoes online. Not the lighters. Zippo, yeah. So Zappos, by the way, sold for $1 billion to Amazon. I read it and I was like, what? It's a shoe selling company online. They make a lot of money. How did they start? It was basically these two guys. They were out of jobs during the recession, in the tech crash, basically. And they're out of jobs, and they're like, hey, let's think about ideas of things that we could sell online. And so they brainstormed different things, and one of the guys was like, what about shoes? Can we sell shoes online? It's like, okay, well, let's try it. So downstairs, they had a shoe shop. Guy took his iPhone, or his phone. I don't know if it was an iPhone back then. He took his phone, and he started taking photos of the shoes in the shoe shop, posted them online on a little website, put prices on them, and every time someone bought a shoe, he would run downstairs, buy the shoe, and then put it into the mail. So he didn't make any money. In fact, he probably lost money on doing this. But why did he do it? Yeah, he just wanted to see if he wanted to validate this business, this idea of selling shoes online. Well, boy, did it ever pay off. And then the last one is the 4-hour work week. So you actually don't necessarily need to apply this just to selling products. Timothy, anyone read this book? Tim Ferriss. Yeah, you read it. Okay, cool. Tim Ferriss, basically this, I guess, personal success guru. He wrote this book called The 4-Hour Workweek. But he had a big argument with his publisher. And the publisher was like, oh, you have to call it the 10 steps to blah, blah, blah. And he was like, no, I want to call it the 4-Hour Workweek. And so it could have just been a big argument. And you know, maybe no one would have won. But then he was like, okay, let's just test it out. So what he did is he put up two identical websites. This is before he finished writing the book. He put up two identical websites, one website, 4-Hour Work Week, one website with the other title, and he put pre-order forms on both of those websites. So you could order the book on either one. It's just the only difference between them was the title of the book. And then he put a bunch of money into Google Ads, and he just looked at which website did people click into the most based on the book title. And which website did people pre-order the most? And then that was his answer for which was a better book title, right? It wasn't a question of opinion. It was, again, this idea of let's do something that's evidence-based. Let's not try to guess how to solve George Washington's, you know, sore throat. Let's actually figure out what's the best way to do it. And so that's what they did. All right, so you've got three options. I'm gonna say you guys are not allowed to do an exploration test. You guys are allowed to do a pitch test and a concierge test. You have 2 minutes. Tell me how you're going to run your experiment for either of those. Tell me where you're going to run it for your valet service. Be able to tell me what the details are. Is it a pitch? Is it a concierge? How are you going to do it? Okay? So tell me what your experiment is, and we will come back in 2 minutes to have a look at them. Any questions? No? Okay. Yes, is the interview one, but you're not going to do an exploration for this one. Just figure out what could be a pitch experiment, You're going to pitch this service to someone. How are you going to pitch it? Like, how are you going to market it, maybe? Or concierge is actually doing it. Yeah. Like what I was, yeah, basically. I thought it would take, I didn't think it would take, yeah. It was actually a pretty full workshop.
Wow.
Valet counter at free parking during peak hours at 10, 12, and 2. Okay. That's all. Are you doing anything for your marketing, or is just that?
We'll just check on how many people just stop.
So you're not going to actually run it?
No, there's no one there.
There's no one there. Oh, so you're just seeing how many people are curious.
Yes.
But then, like, that doesn't really tell you if they're going to be a buyer, right?
But during peak hours and people are rushing, because it's common, everyone would know that during that peak hours, the parking would be extremely far at the end. So wondering if people would actually stop and then wonder if the service is
available. Right, okay. So let's say the price is clearly put up and then there's a valet box there, and you just want to see someone stopping. And then, like, oh, okay, they look around, they're like, is there someone here? And then, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, fine, fair enough. What else do you guys have as tests?
Like, we came up with the idea where we just run it. Like, we have the booth, or say we have someone there.
Yeah.
And then we put different prices. So, say, $20 for me, and we would just basically take the car, go park it somewhere. And then when they come, we just bring it back to them and all that. And then for each week, we change the price and see how many people come.
Okay.
During what day, timing and all that.
So I really love this one. What they're doing is they're actually running the service. And I think this is actually the kind of thing that's really easy to test. You might as well just run it. And they're going to switch the pricing from week to week. To see like what people actually accept. So what I would recommend is there's a strategy called price skimming. And so the idea behind price skimming is you start with a high price and then you just keep bringing it down until you see like, oh, people are actually biting at this price, right? You keep bringing it down. Because if you have the price at one level and you increase, people get upset. So price skimming is a good strategy for that. So, you know, so not only are you finding out whether people want it, but you're finding out what price people, what prices people are willing to do it. What else have we got as experiments? Yes?
We set up a poster.
Uh-huh.
Or a website. But an email to see if they're interested. We send you an email to see how many people.
So you set up a poster and you put up an email and you see how many people email in interested. Or at least, you need something more committal than email, ideally. But at least you know that they've gone through some effort. So that's a pitch test. I think that's good. They've given you an email. It's already some currency. Anything else? No other tests? That's not a test, though. That doesn't tell you anything. All right. Cool. So I'm going to run you guys quickly through an experiment. I'm not going to run you guys through. I'm just going to show you how we would do it. So this is a company called How's the UX. And so basically, we put the customer and the problem up. We test, we run the test on this assumption, and then we validate it. We run the next riskiest, assumption. We validate it. In this case, it's a two-sided market. So this startup is kind of like eBay. You need to have buyers and you need to have sellers. So we're going to need to test the buyer side and we need to test the seller side, right? We do the same thing. We keep running these tests. We invalidated this test. So this test, we ran it, and it turned out people didn't want this. So we changed. We changed the group. We validated it, and so that's how we did. And so the big question for you as you guys are running your campaigns is, you know, your crowdfunding campaign is going to need to offer something to people, right? And you're going to need to test whether that thing that you're offering is interesting to them. And so this is how you do it. And the big question for us as a startup is, what's the rate of validation? How many experiments can we run in a day or in a week? That's the biggest question for us. Now, if you guys, uh, I understand that there's some particular topics that you guys might need to follow for your crowdfunding campaign, but if you guys are interested, we just launched a crowdfunding platform called Give.my. It is specifically to support teacher projects. So in basically underprivileged schools, we've got projects which are, you know, up to 5,000 ringgit, basically. Teachers raising funds to do, you know, for materials to do science experiments and stuff like that. Some really cool stuff up here. If you want to pick out one of the projects and support it, I'd be more than happy to help you guys out. The real measure of success is the number of experiments that can be crowded into 24 hours. Any guesses as to who said this? Who might have said this? It's a quote. No, it wasn't me. Well, I mean, maybe I said, I just did. But I'm not the one who originated it. Is it an old or new quote? I'm not going to say. Einstein, okay. Any other guesses? So this quote was actually Thomas Edison. Not a very startup guy, you would think. But very startup-y thing to say. So that's it for me today. If you have any questions, I'll be here, or you can drop me an email. Thanks very much, guys.